Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus. Wonderful Jesus.
Chest with jewels in it and had my name on it, and I just I screamed out in a triumphant voice and sang in a tongue that I've never sung before, like a child would sing a melody, like a triumphant melody. And it was just an amazing time. And I just wanted to testify, to say thank you, God, for honouring my obedience and my humility that he convicted me to come forward for. And I'm walking in the freedom, and I know it's there. And just to testify, in terms of the ante of anger is peace. And I walked into work the next day, not saying anything. And this new girl's not Christian at all. Use the words like this. It's not usually like a woman in her 20s, you know, says the word peaceful. But she just looked at me, she's like, whoa. And I was like, just smiled, like, what? She's like, you just look so peaceful. And I just smiled, I was like, oh yeah, I was at a prayer meeting last night, and it was just amazing. So I'm not just chilled, I'm sub-zero right now. So, you know, God does what he does even, yeah. So that was it really. I hope that helps. Thank you for having me.
You encountered God in that prayer meeting, you will encounter God in this one. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will rest upon you. And people will see at your place of work, and neighbor will see you say, wow, you're looking peaceful. It means you are high blood pressure free. In Jesus' name. Next person, short one. 5 minutes.
Very quick. My name's Dave. I'm a mobile chiropodist. And for months, I've been struggling to get work. And then this afternoon, Pastor Anthony's wife introduced me to someone who's allowing me into a care home on a 3-month probation, which is actually going to blow up my work. Oh, it's still trying to get my head around it. It's just literally to the ear. It's incredible. If it happens, it's not just one care home, is it three he's got? Which is a possibility of a fourth one as well. It's just. I was putting some flyers out the other day as I was coming up the hill on Coppice Road, you know, with the co-op list that's coming up the top. Literally, I heard God's voice saying, your breakthrough's coming. Literally, just said in my head, your breakthrough's coming. And then today, it's like that.
I thought I'd share this with you guys. You know, sometimes God places a burden on your heart, you know, for somebody. And you know, places a burden on my heart, you know, for this man who I've met. You know, I've had a friend working in a shop, you know, and people coming into that shop, broken people. And this particular guy came in several weeks ago, and he's a drunkard, basically. He'd come into the shop in the morning, buying alcohol. He'd come in drunk, buys alcohol, go out, and then come back the following day. And then I started to minister. The Lord gave me a burden, you know, to just minister to him. And I started speaking in his life. And now, it's a long story, but I won't take all that long. But essentially, you know, I started telling him about Jesus, that there's a better way. He doesn't have to live like that. And he kept saying, well, I'm a sinner. I'm going to go to hell anyway. You know, there's no hope for me. He says, you know, I'm going to hell. I said to him, no, do not speak him like that. I said, you don't have to go to hell. You can make a choice to live or to die.
Yeah.
And look, I invited him to come into this place for prayer. And he came. And there's another lady who came with me. We sat here. And I said to him, we spoke to him at length for nearly 2 hours. And then we said, you know, can we pray for you? And, you know, he stood up right here. And I just put my hand on him. And I just, you know, started to, I said, Father. And as I said that, he just went like that. And he says, you can't pray for me. And he walked out. Now, we stood our ground, you know, me and the other lady, you know, Sharon, and we prayed for him. A week later, we invited him back here again. And we sat again for about another hour. And at the end of it, we said, can we pray for you? And he said, yes. This time, we were able to pray for him. But he wasn't able to make a commitment. On Wednesday, we brought him here again, third time, and we spent some time, and basically I said to him, look, you've given rights to the enemy, because at one time he actually got down on his knees and he said to the devil, give me power, devil, give me power. And I said to him, you know, I said, Jesus can make a difference, but I said, you need to renounce the devil and all his works first. before you can get Jesus come into your life. And we spoke to him, and I said, this is about life and death. You know, you can choose life or death right now. And he said, I want to live. I want life. Now, the other thing as well, you know, he got into all sorts of problems with the police. He was on license. He did something. He was due to go to court this morning. And he was saying, I don't want to go to prison. He said, if he goes to prison, he's going to die, basically. So we've been praying for him, you know, that God would show him his favours. Yes. But the beautiful thing about on Wednesday, like I said, he actually decided to renounce the devil, yeah, and to give his life to the Lord. Yeah. And right here in this place, you know, he actually renounced the devil, and give his life to the Lord. So I want to give God thanks for his salvation, because now he's on a different path.
Yes.
But just to show God's favour again, you know, he didn't want to go to prison. So we've been praying, you know, Pastor Joseph and all the team and everybody else have been saying, pray for this man, pray for this man. Yeah. Even last night he called me and he said, Viv, I'm worried, I'm going to go to prison. I said, we've been praying. He said, don't worry about it. His girlfriend, not his friend, his woman, but not girlfriend, she was bawling her eyes balls out. She said, I don't want you to go to prison. And I, you know, reassured her, said, we've been praying, you know, we've asked God to show favor. Just put it in the hands of the Lord. So this morning, now, he rang me this morning and said, Viv, he says, I'm going to go to court. He said, if I don't ring you, then you know that I'm in prison. I'm locked up, basically. Anyway, I went to meet at 11 o'clock, and at 1 o'clock, I looked at my phone. It called me twice. Mm. And when I eventually spoke to him, he said, he's a free man. He said that when the magistrate walked into the court, he said the magistrate, you know, there's something about the magistrate, and they said the magistrate more or less gave him that reassurance that he wasn't going to jail. And sure enough, he did not go to jail, even though he committed something. So I just want to say God is great. God is good. And you know, I just want to encourage you guys as well. You know, when God places a burden on your heart to stand with somebody, stand with them,
yes,
because
yes.
they do need. But I give God glory today. You know what he says.
Pastor Don. Thank you very much. Let me take this moment to greet you all the ministers, bishops, and all of you wonderful folks that are here today. This is a time of reflecting on what God has done and still to do. My testimony is a bit of a long one, but I will cut it up, even though I was told I can have a little bit of time. Now, years ago, I had a thing called a sciatica, which is a chopped nerve, and it was in both sides. I didn't have it from this, which is in here. And this, they say, doesn't go away. It stays with you forever because it's a chopped nerve. So, one time you feel good, another time you just feel twinge. Now, in September, I start feeling a pain because I'm a chef and I stand a lot. So I thought, more or less, it's because of the pain from the side where it came back. So I went to the doctor and they sent me for some physio. Now I've been doing the physio and I thought, this thing is not working. So I went back to the doctor and I said, well, it's not working, I'm not going to be going back to do it. So he said, okay, what you need to do is to let them sign you up, and when they send the report, I will put you onto something else. But during that time, the doctor that I was seeing would be going for holiday, so for 2 weeks, so I wouldn't be able to see that doctor. So I said to my wife, can you book me to see any doctor? So I went, I saw this Asian doctor, and at the time I was walking, look at me, it's the mirror. Come on, somebody. I was walking like this. I was down here because I didn't have a stick. So I was all the way down here. When I'm coming from work, the folks that see me, that knew me across the sidewalk, they would be going. And some people meet me and I'm trying to, you know, play as if I'm all right. But they already know because I'm taught that something isn't right. So obviously, when I went down to see the doctor, he asked me to lie down and raise this leg. And And then to raise this one, I couldn't raise it. Give God the glory. What used to happen when I wake up in the morning and get myself together and put my trousers on, I had to sit down, use this hand to lift this leg to push it into my trousers. When I get to work to put my uniform, I have to do the same thing. Sit down, raise to get it into the trousers. Now, when I went back now to see this doctor, he said, okay, a matter of fact, as I lay and he said to raise my leg, and I couldn't, he said to get up. And he said, okay, I'll put it through for the blood test and also to do scans. When the result came back, now this other doctor that I've seen before, he came back, so I had a missed call on my phone. And I thought, let me call. When I called, the nurse said to come in the morning to see the doctor. But by the time the surgery should close, I had another call. The doctor is asking that I should come in. So I thought, something is funny. You know, why are they calling me so many times? So when I went, he sat me down and he put the computer on and he began to say, what I'm going to tell you, you should ask the counsel. So I'm thinking, hey. Anyhow, he explained and he points out that I had the prostate, the results show prostate over 2,000, the reading, the PSA. I don't know if you all know, you know, the men might not understand there, so over 2,000. Now they quickly put me through scans, everything, etc. Was an experience, great experience. So during that time, going through the scans and everything, then they gave me some tablets to take at the beginning, and then after the tablet went out, I got an injection. Many people are praying all around the world. You know, when I say all around the world, different parts of the world, I'm exaggerating too much. So, and even you men here, in prayer, you know, thank God for you, for your prayers. But the passage you read, Pastor Joey, I begin to use that passage and I begin to declare from Psalms 91, verse 11 there, that the Lord will give his angels charge, hallelujah, over me and over any one of his children. Now you don't pray to the angel, because angels are waiting for to be released by God in order that you and I can be delivered, can be blessed, can be protected. Because if we don't ask God to release the angel just sit down, relaxing, lazy. So I begin to quote that and use that passage. Now, when I went back 2 weeks ago Thursday for another test, they told me that on the Friday I will get the report. But by the time the surgery should close, I got a phone call and it was a nurse. Nurse said that the consultant said, make sure he get the report immediately. 2,000. And it came down to 3.6. Well, when this happened, you got to remember that it's not about me, it's about God.
Yes.
Now, I want to say this clearly, because this, when you hear the word cancer, people die already. Did you know that?
Yes.
You die already, but the devil is a liar.
Yes.
You don't have to die. Just know that you can still live. And it can also go completely of your body. As well as you can still have it, but you live. So when the devil throws that thing called fear, on you, you're killing yourself immediately. So what I began to do when I was told that, of course, it wasn't easy. Because I remember years ago when I was younger, I went to see somebody that had that cancer, and I could not take it. I was so worried for the person. So when this was told to me, I was like, wow, all that memory started coming back, you know? So I begin to declare in the name of Jesus, hallelujah, that nothing will block the flow of God in my life. Now, not because I'm a pastor. Somebody might think, oh, why a pastor? I'm a human living on the earth, but also I'm a man of God, living God, hallelujah. So I just want to give God praise for what he has done. And he's doing a lot more. And when you all hear this testimony, I don't know what you're going through sitting here, but God is able to do the impossible. Just continue to pray and love the Lord, and he will work it all out. Thank you very much.
That countdown from 3,000 to 3. To 2.
2,000.
Is a God that reverses the irreversible. Now, you might not be able to, some of us might struggle to relate with that kind of testimonies. It says, when I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil. See, when you get doctor's report, that's when you understand what that scripture says about walking through the valley or the shadow of the death. Now, in Ephesians chapter 6, it talks about the armor. It says, never carry but the shield of faith in which you can quench the fiery darts of the enemy. Now, it's the shield that you carry that can quench the arrows of fear. That what will work for you is your faith in God and in what you do. And he said it was what? Speaking the word. Speaking the word. God has exalted his own word, even above his own name. There is power in the word. Let us worship God.
Yeah.
How great thou art in the name of Jesus. Oh, my soul.
Oh,
Lord Almighty God. We lift your name higher. We lift your name higher, God. Be glorified in this place. Be glorified in this place. Across the night, God. We lift your name higher. Across the nation's heart. Oh, across the land, God. We lift your name higher.
Change them, all the enemies, all the people's wrath, all they say, in the name.
someone. From this day. Sister Julia, welcome. Sister Dara, you are not allowed. When I said your husband is praying with a different style since you came back, you know, he's been a patchy up for some time. So now I can see style of prayer. He's more praying with confidence now. That's the power. That's what a good wife can do to a good man. Amen. God bless you, man. It's good to see you. And now we're about to go into the Word from our very own pastor. So now, I call him my big brother. You know, when I came to this city, I didn't know anyone. The only person I knew when I came to this city was myself. And it's so sad, you know. When I stepped in this city, the only person I knew was myself. But now, to the glory of God, God has enlarged my coast. I know people. I've got big sisters. I've got big sisters, Sister Polake. I've got fathers. I've got big brothers. I've got pastors. I've got mamas. I've got friends all over. It's a privilege to be a child of the living God. It's a privilege to be a child of the living God. I can imagine, I have so many Christian friends. Wow, that's a miracle. It's amazing, you know. I'm not taking it for granted. Like, I have believers, those who believe in God. It's a privilege. So I'm going to call on Big Brother Donald. Put your hands together. Come on, celebrate my brother. Celebrate Jesus in his life.